started my water depletion last night. Checked my weight, and around 11:30 at night, I took the scales at 268.4 pounds. So I've been in the hot tub, and both here in our room and down over at the pool for a handful of hours. That's why I like the hot tub. It's great because you can sit down, and the muscles aren't doing anything but cooking in a pot of water like a piece of stew. I can't really do cardio when it comes to cutting weight, you know, not for a powerlifting competition, because it takes your legs away. Sitting in a really high-tech Dodge Caravan. It's all black, so it soaks up some sunlight. It's about 92 degrees here in Orlando today. So even though it's about 30 back home in Chicago, so we're soaking up as much sun as we can into the car here and picking up some heat. Using a little Netflix to pass the time, I guess. It's probably about 160, 170 degrees in the car. You know, I've cut weight my whole life, it seems. But it's part of the journey and every competition, you know, and like I hate it, but it's, I don't know, it's it's kind of like meditating in the desert, you know. it focuses you on the task at hand. When it comes time to cut weight, it's just you alone with your thoughts. You're torturing yourself, so you gotta be able to kind of push through that. But it's also kind of cleansing in a way. Oddly enough, there's a whole new level of focus, and it's just one step in the journey to getting through the meet. And it's kind of weird, but I almost look forward to it now. So I've been in the hot tub a handful of hours, and I'm hoping I've lost about 10 pounds. So if the scale says 250, I'll be very happy. Check the scale, and 248.8 with some swim trunks on them. These don't weigh a whole lot because they're kind of dry at this point, but I was expecting it to be in still over 250, so that's huge. So 248.8 is awesome. That means we only got six pounds or so left to cut. It gives me a little bit of room to get some extra nutrition in today. And then, take a little bit of a break here too. So I'm starting to feel a little overheated. Not too bad, but to the point where we can take a break. And by taking a break, the only problem is the core temperature drops down, but it also allows your skin to fill back up with some water. So it's easy to start sweating again. So that's huge. That's a big relief. Big relief. weird too when your body gets depleted of things. You crave it. And it tastes infinitely better than it normally would. So right now, obviously, I'm short on water. This has got water in it. And I'm short on potassium. This has got potassium in it. So it just makes it taste 10 times better than it normally would. And I've been sick all week, so extra vitamin C in this is only going to help too. So we get to eat a little bit extra right now. My weight was about 2 pounds lower than I thought it was going to be, so to put a little extra nutrition in. So we got a protein bar here. This might look gross, but it is amazing. I'm going to eat it nice and slow and relish it. And it's so good. Inside my mouth is so hot right now.
Matthew, growing up early on, I wouldn't say hyper, but very active.
He was the type of child when we would go out to eat when he was very little that he had a hard time sitting still.
Remember horror stories from my parents trying to go out to dinner and they couldn't get me to sit still and I just sprint circles around the table. I still feel that way to this day. I don't feel like I can sit still for very long at all. Particularly at a desk.
He's very tenacious, so he always went after things full speed. I think one of the things that we always talked about, whether it was in his sports or his schoolwork, was always to keep trying, try hard. If at first you don't succeed, continue to work on it so that you can accomplish what your goal was at the beginning.
So, you know, Matthew had that extra energy, and then over the years he developed some tics, some motor tics over the years. And it really seemed like that the, not only the sports seemed to help with that, but the lifting seemed to help with that. That it actually helped direct that energy into something that he could release it through lifting, if that makes sense.
I remember my parents were real nervous or apprehensive about exercise, and they were worried that I'd hurt myself doing it. And my grandma was always kind of a good listener when it came to Christmas presents, and I got a bench press for my 14th, for Christmas when I was 14.
Funny story, when we went to Florida, the second time we went to Florida, he was 14 or 15 at the time, we had to bring his weights with. So it was important to him that he wanted to bring that. And again, I think it was really helpful with the energy to help bring them. But the look we got, and luckily at the time they didn't weigh your luggage, but we had a whole big suitcase full of weights that he brought with. And the looks we got from the people at the airport, when they're going to grab your bag and put it on the belt was like, seriously? I'm like, oh well, so we got through it. That's what, helped him. And it seemed to help him with that energy and the tics that he had. And he continued to do that then, like I said, and not that we encouraged it more, but we knew that it seemed to help him.
We first came across the idea that he may have had some motor tics, and those motor tics were associated with Tourette's syndrome, which had obsessive compulsive along with it, and the motor tics as well. And I think the activities, the sports, the weightlifting all carried into his routines that he followed throughout his day, and the weightlifting helped to release some of that tension that he had.
So I remember when I was about 15, I was at a doctor's office with my mom. That was the day we found out, and the doctor was talking to my mom in the other room, and I remember overhearing that exercise really helped a lot with that. And, I kind of ran with it. I started exercising every night in my bedroom from that point on.
To be a police officer, the females have to be able to bench 58% of their body weight. And so I was like, oh, I'll get a personal trainer who can help me do that. I was super weak. And so I had a personal trainer, and our sessions expired, and that was like when Matt was pretty new to the gym. And so he sat me down and sold me a lot of personal training with a personal trainer who probably wasn't the best fit for me.
I was a general manager at an export, and she was paying a ton of money for personal training there that I had probably sold her, or did sell her.
Finally, he said, well, I bench press on Tuesdays, or whatever day it was. Come with me every Tuesday, and I'll make sure you can pass your bench press for your police test. And I did that, and then we pretty much, after like 2 weeks, I was pretty much working out with him every single day.
So she started showing up, and her bench press started getting better, and she passed her police test and got hired as a cop, and then just started showing up all the time for my workouts, and we became good friends that way. And, yeah, the rest is history.
You know, it's always nice to have motivation to work out, and just spending time with him and getting to know other people. It was great.
.242
and a half.
242.5
press.
280.
Tough one
batter,
huh?
I made it.
Was it tough?
You know, it kept coming off pretty smooth. You know, it was just a lot of heat, that's all, the whole day. How you doing? Skinny.
Matt Minuth.
We started at 225.
I got
255 squat.
For a bit. Always cutting down and getting bigger.
305 deadlift.
Tomorrow I'll be
275. For me?
What time we at?
I don't know. I think I'm at 720.
A couple minutes here.
241. Good job.
I got on her right around like 12:30 at night, and then I woke up this morning and peed for like, what the hell? How did that happen? I couldn't pee all day.
Yeah, sometimes it takes a while.
Yeah. All right, man. God bless, buddy. Happy
Steve.
Day.
Steve. Oh,
thank you. I'm used to seeing those guys, you know. So for me, it's more of a mind game that they try to play with me. Like a couple of them. You know, they won't look at me, they won't shake my hand. You know, even though we're friends, you know, I'm friends with all those guys and get along great with all of them. But some of them, when it's game day, they put on their game day face, and then I'm the enemy. And I don't play that game. I try to do the opposite game. You know, I make them all feel bad by being extra friendly.
Holy Father, we ask for blessings in this food that might nourish our bodies. And so through his precious name and through his gracious heart.
Your sides are here. I don't know what belongs or what.
Thank you.
No
Powerlifting meet is composed of the three big lifts, the squat, the bench press, and the deadlift. The squat goes first. You get three attempts. Whatever weight that you decide that you want to open with, you have to stick with. If you miss it, you can't go down in weight. you can only repeat the same weight or go up. The following is the bench press. The bench press is the greatest test of upper body strength. The last lift that occurs is the deadlift. And the deadlift is probably the greatest overall test of human strength. It's just brute power. When most people think of the strongest event in the world, or what determines who the strongest person in the world is, it usually boils down to the deadlift.
We get there nice and early. He likes to be there early just to make sure that he has enough time to warm up. He doesn't want to be crunched for time. He likes to go around and say, you know, hello to people he hasn't seen in a while. He was dragging that day at the beginning.
Well, the WPO historically has been, you know, the best meet in the world to do. That one in particular, being that they hadn't had it in so many years, brought a lot of the best lifters in the world out of retirement, and it just brought them all to that meet. So it was going to be not only the toughest meet that I could have ever tried to do, but the most intense in terms of the level of competition.
I don't know. He maintains this external calmness, I guess you would say, that is perceived by us and others as just like this gentle giant, because I don't know if he's really anxious inside or not, but he doesn't seem to outwardly express any like anxiety or stress over things, and man, it's very admirable. I wish I could have that same type of feeling, you know.
So I always hope, start a little lower and then work your way up. That's my thought process. I don't think it's always his thought process. So when I've seen him and he goes to lift, I don't know which one's the easiest to watch. It might be the squat.
So yeah, for me, the most I had ever successfully squatted at a meet was 1,000 pounds. And I'd probably done that 5 or 6 meets in a row and couldn't ever seem to quite break past that by much. And so I got my opening attempt, you know, at the meet pretty easy, but I know I wasn't the best squatter there. There were several other lifters there that are amazing squatters, you know, guys that have squatted well over 1,100. So I thought I was going to get my ass handed to me in the squat at that meet. And in the second attempt, my caller, Rudy Rosales from Overkill, put me at, I think, 1040 for the second attempt. Right around there, and I knew that was going to be tough for me, but I felt like I had it in the cards, and with the squat suit on, I felt like I was going to get the support that I needed out of the suit for that to be successful. On the third attempt, I didn't want to go any heavier than 1080. I even thought about not taking a third attempt. I thought the second attempt was good enough, and that I should save my energy for the bench press. Went back, you know, into the warm-up area and sat down and got my name called for the third attempt and walked out and saw 1102 on the bar. And I remember thinking about how mad I was at Rudy. And the other lifters had all taken 1102 as well, but missed. I don't know if there's a lot you can say to yourself when somebody, you know, puts more weight on there than you think that you're capable of, other than, you know, just trying to stay calm and collective and visualize what it's going to take for that weight to move. And that's really the trick, is not getting anxious about it and just taking some deep breaths and relaxing.
I'm
fatherly worry when he goes to lift. I mean, it's definitely there. But again, I just always try to be peaceful about it and pray for peace and definitely pray for protection over him while he's lifting. And I always pray for the people that are helping him, that they always catch the bar just in case. That's a biggie.
He's kind of a nerd, I'm not gonna lie. He's into Harry Potter, he's into Star Wars. The gym's his life, but it's not his life. He's so much more than just the average powerlifter. If Matt was a superhero, his superpower would definitely be bench press. He's just, he's a monster at it. You know, if you want bench press advice, you go to Matt Minuth.
I remember like mowing the lawn when I was younger. I'd make an entire lap around our yard with the lawnmower, and I'd go in the garage and I'd do a set of bench press, and then I'd make another lap around and I'd come back and I'd do another set of bench press. I just always liked that lift more than the rest of them. So going into the day, I knew like my greatest strength and my greatest weakness was going to be the bench press. I knew I could outlift everybody on the bench, but I also knew that I was having trouble in my bench shirt.
I remember him coming home for a weekend, and we went into a local commercial gym and were working out, and I was off into the corner on a piece of cardio equipment, and I noticed everybody in the room kind of staring off into a different direction and stopping what they were doing. And I looked over to see Matthew in the corner stacking plates on the bench, and the bar was actually bending. Yeah, he was moving above and beyond the regular guy who just goes to the gym to work out.
Yeah, it's just always been a lift that comes easy for me. I think naturally I have a little bit more chest development in that area versus, you know, some of the other lifts. You know, you see these guys with gigantic quads or gigantic glutes, and you know, for me, I've just always, you know, been a little bit more adapted in the upper body in that respect. I felt pretty confident going into the bench press, you know, even though I knew that the shirt was, you know, it was a little too tight on me. I took my opener and didn't get it. And the opener was 9:25. Going into the second attempt, I didn't think I had any chance to finish the meet. I thought I was gonna bomb. So luckily the manufacturer of the equipment, a friend of mine, and he was down there, you know, at the meet with us, and he made some suggestions, and one of them was baby powder. And so he threw some baby powder on my arms, and was able to slip my arms down into the shirt a little bit more and got it up to the right angle to the point where it was gonna allow me to find my groove, if you will, for the next attempt.
Expressions from the people in the audience, and how excited he was, and the people that were helping him. The excitement, or you know, in the room changed, and I realized, oh, this is something that's big, and I didn't realize it at the time.
The weight felt pretty light in my hands, which is always a good feeling, even though that much weight never feels good in your hands. It kind of feels like it's gonna crush your palms. Got the lockout, and then that was it. I knew I didn't have another chance at a third attempt, and that attempt just exhausted me. So we passed on the third attempt for the bench press and saved the rest for the deadlift. Yeah, I mean, just the lull between the bench press and the deadlift, that, you know, there's a little bit of extra electricity in the area, if we will, because, you know, it started to click with a lot of people there, especially a lot of the other athletes, that, you know, breaking 2700 was a very big possibility now. And I actually took my deadlift number down on my opening attempt just to make sure that I could get it. Usually I always open up over 700 pounds, and I knew that I only needed 677, I think, to break the world record.
Now, when he walked out onto that platform, I could see the calmness in him, and somebody said that he was starting a little bit lighter than what he would normally start out his number at for his deadlift, and I didn't quite understand that, but obviously he's got a method of doing what he needed to do to get that number. So I thought, well, maybe he'll start low and work his way up.
Yeah, I'd just gotten done taking a 925-pound bench press, and my back was, you know, really tight from that, and it was hard to convince myself to calm down and get ready for the deadlift. You know, the crowd is realizing how much weight is on the bar, and, you know, the announcer, you know, made sure that everybody knew that this was going to be an all-time world record, and so the emotions were high walking out. So I, you know, had been trying to keep myself calm all day, and then you know, that brought it all to a head at once. You know, like knowing, hey, you know, man, like 15 years of training for this sport, the weight was finally on the bar. You know, so my mom and dad were there, my sister who's never been there before, and my nieces and nephews, and you know, my fiance, and then my beautiful little daughter, and so it was a big moment for me. So I got up to the platform, and you know, the weight shot right off the ground. It was super light.
Can I go out there with something over it?
Yeah. It's almost like a sleeve here.
Yeah. Can I get something to tie it off?
You have elbow sleeves.
Yeah, I'll
sleeve.
Sleeve.
He's got elbow sleeves.
You can.
You
can.
Wrist wrap.
Can I get a fucking just something compression on it?
I instantly knew that I tore my bicep off the bone. Tendon just snapped. So I had to go back and, you know, think about whether or not we were going to finish the meet.
He needs to finish tearing it off, or they won't fix it until complete tear. I had it done for me. They won't touch it until it's completely torn.
What was that on?
Switch grips.
Yeah, switch grips.
All right, let me.
You want a knee sleeve?
Yeah.
Do we have one?
And my entire family had flown down there, and like I said, I've been training for this for 15 years, and yeah, I didn't want the moment to go by. You never know when that last meet's gonna be or when your last opportunity to shine is. So I went back out for the second attempt. were so swollen from the tear, at least my left hand was, that it just, the weight just shot right out of my hands again and hit the ground like a ton of bricks. You know, I'm not an overly big guy, so that much weight in my hands, just, it's a lot of pressure on the little muscles in your palms, and they just start to swell up incredibly. So you kind of need your hands to deadlift. It's the most important aspect of the lift. Doesn't matter how strong your lower back or your legs are, if your hands can't hold on to the weight, it doesn't matter.
And at that point, I didn't know what he was thinking, and that was to change his strategy for his grip. And I think at that point, I can see in his eyes, and I said, Matt, if you're planning on doing this, you know, focus, focus, focus. And he just looked at me, shook his head, and I knew that he could do it.
I mean, part of it's a fuck it thing. We're going for it anyways, and nothing's gonna take that moment away from you. You've worked, you know, decades for that chance to, you know, do something, you know, special, if you want to call it that. And then a lot of it's pride, and feeling an obligation to not letting people down. You know, there's a lot of people that, like I said, help you with something like this, and your training partners and your family, and you know, like, fuck, I feel like a horrible dad every Saturday morning. I go to the gym and I train, and you know, my daughter doesn't come with me. You know, I'm here by myself. It's a selfish thing. And you know, for all those hours that I've, you know, taken away from her, you know, to pursue, you know, a goal or a dream that I have, like looking at her out in the audience sitting there, like, I wasn't gonna, you know, throw away those hundreds of hours that we could have spent together, you know, just because, you know, my eyes are hurt.
You know, it was a good close to that week. Obviously, we went there for the purpose of him competing and being there for him. And the way that day ended with that type of thrill, being so scared for him, but being so excited for him. On the other side of that, Carl and I are very blessed to have him as our child and very proud of him, everything that he's accomplished in life.
And I couldn't imagine it as a lifter because at the end, I can barely walk out of there and I didn't lift any weight. But I go in there, I know that's long now that I've been to quite a few, and I just try to be the positive of that he needs to keep going for the hours and hours that he's working out.
His heart is bigger than his soul, and it makes me very, very, very proud to say that he's my son, to be his dad, and he's challenged himself and would never give up. And if I think more people were like that, they would find themselves in a better place maybe as well.
I think that's it. So just no matter what, you know, no matter what curveball life throws at you, you know, you can always bounce back from it. Just stay motivated. Have God on your side. Believe that you have God on your side. And believe in yourself enough to know that you can handle anything.